resting inside. We cannot contain your love will surely confine us.
I'm not on?
There we are.
There we go. Good morning, church. How are you this morning? Sweet God of mercy. Oh, we're mercy, mercy indeed. Friends, it is good to be with you on this beautiful Sunday morning in Central Virginia. The sun is shining bright today. It's January temperatures. It's chilly and just a gorgeous day here in Chesterfield County. Here at Trinity United Methodist Church, our inclusively online worship service this morning. We continue to have our in-person worship paused through at least next Sunday. We'll be reconsidering and looking at that. And all of that, of course, is due to COVID-19 and the pandemic that surrounds us. A couple of things just to draw your attention to. Next Sunday morning, Reverend Herb Reynoldson will be here to preach and bring the word. And this morning we have a guest preacher. Herb's no guest, but this morning we have a guest preacher as well, Jonah. Amittai's son, will be with us to bring us a word today. And I, for one, am looking forward to that. Jonah's going to help us connect some dots and continue us on this message of following God's star and the vision that God is casting for us as individuals in a church and a world. And as you know, over the last several weeks, we have remembered our baptism, that wake-up call to recall and remember that God has given us the power to resist evil and to do good in the world. And we've remembered that Christ is calling us to come and see what He is up to in the world and inviting us to be a part of it, a participant in it. And today we'll explore a different angle on that call and response, hearing the first-person story of one who tried to get out of it and struggled with it and resisted it for as long as he possibly could. So we're looking forward to that today. As we transition and prepare to sing our songs of praise, we've got a little call to worship we want to do with you this morning. So friends, it is time to become focused, not on our wants or complaints, but on God. In the silent places of my soul, I turn to God, for God alone is our rock and salvation.
Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the good news of God, saying, "The time has come, the realm of God."
The realm of God is not very far from any one of us, for in God we live and move and have our being.
Jesus said, "Repent and believe in the good news. The time has come."
In the silent places of my soul, I turn to God, for God alone is our rock and our salvation. Friends, our praise songs this morning will start with Cornerstone, and then we'll follow that with Where He Leads Me. Up on your feet, let's sing.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I did not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing. Jesus' blood and righteousness. I did not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, great strong. Seems to hide His face. I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Shall come. with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone.
The scripture lesson this morning comes from Jonah chapter 3, verses 1 through 5 and 10. The Lord's word came to Jonah a second time. Get up and go to Nineveh, that great city, and declare against it the proclamation that I am commanding you. And Jonah got up and went to Nineveh, according to the Lord's word. Now Nineveh was indeed an enormous city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah started into the city, walking one day, and he cried out, "Just 40 days more, and Nineveh will be overthrown." and the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast and put on mourning clothes, from the greatest of them to the least significant. God saw that what they were doing, that they had ceased their evil behavior. So God stopped planning to destroy them, and he didn't do it.
Hi, I don't think we've met. My name is Jonah. I'm Amittai's son. You may have heard of me. My story is in the Bible. It's nestled in with the other prophets in the Old Testament stories. It's a great story. Not because of me, but because of God. I've had lots of preachers and prophets over the years tell me that they relate to my story because they too, many of them, tried to run away when God called them. They didn't have much success. Some of them will tell me, too, that they have also wrestled with doing what God wanted them to do because they didn't agree with it or like it, and that's part of my story. Parents tell me they love my story because it's a great moral lesson for children about taking responsibility for your own behavior, not running away from your problems. And little kids, they love my story. They love to draw those pictures of me being in the belly of the big fish. I love getting those pictures of the big fish with me standing right in the heart of it, right in the belly of the fish. What our little children don't realize is that it was not like that, me standing alone in the belly of the fish. There were all kinds of other sea creatures, God's creatures in that belly with me. There were squid and octopus and flopping fish, and oh, it smelled so bad. Ugh. Even today, when I think about it, it almost makes me gag all these many, many years later. But I learned a lot in the belly of the big fish. And on the adventure of trying to run away from God and ultimately doing what God wanted, but not very willingly. And I hope today as I tell my story that you too will find something to connect with, that there'll be some aspect of it that speaks to you and your life today. Let us pray. El Shaddai, Almighty God, pour out your Spirit upon us. May we hear what you want us to hear. May we do what you call us to do. Amen. So my story began one day as I'm sitting, as I did most days, sitting outside the city gate in my hometown, and I was doing the thing that I loved to do in those days, which was to make prayer beads. I would carve these little beads and then string them together, and I would pray over them as I made them and created them. This was how I made my living, was making prayer beads and then selling them to folks. I always prayed for the person, too. When a ring was done, a string of prayer beads was done, I would always pray for who would next hold it in their hand. So I'm sitting outside the city gate and with some of the other craftsmen, and we would gather there in the daytime and do our crafts and talk and visit with people as they came in and out of the town. And as I'm sitting there working, the word of the Lord came to me. Jonah, get up and go. Get up and go to that great city Nineveh, for I cannot tolerate their evil anymore. I want you to preach to them. So I got up and I looked down the road towards Nineveh and took a deep breath and turned and went the other way. I went as far as I could go in the opposite direction from Nineveh. I went until I couldn't walk any further, until the land ran out and I butted up against the sea. And then I got me a ticket on a boat to set sail for Tarshish. Now you need to understand that I was, as I continue to be today, a very strong person of faith. It wasn't because I doubted God. It wasn't because I didn't believe in God. I believed in God. I knew that God was a God of mercy. I had experienced that in my own life. And that was the problem, because I knew that God was going to have mercy on those people, and I didn't want that. I despised the people of Nineveh. I had a hardness in my heart for them. I loathed them. I wanted them to suffer, and if God wanted to destroy them for their evil ways, that was okay with me. See, it wasn't that I didn't have faith in God, that I didn't believe in God. It wasn't even that I didn't trust God. Well, maybe. It's that I disagreed with God, and I didn't want to do that, which I didn't want to do. So I boarded that boat, and when we set sail across the sea, I got as far away from God as I could. I went down in the bottom of the boat, down in the hull, lay down, and went to sleep. Even there, God found me. Sometime in the middle of the night, I began to feel the ship as it rocked back and forth. I could tell the waves were picking up and the wind was starting to blow. And then the captain of the ship came down and told me that I had to get up and come on deck and join everyone else who was on deck and come and pray to my God. They were all praying to their gods, and he wanted me to come and pray to my God. And so I went up on deck with him, and there the wind was blowing and the waves were crashing against the boat. The wind was just howling and the waves were crashing, and all of the people on the ship are holding on for dear life, and they're crying out to their gods, "Save us, save us." And I finally tell them, "It is my God who created the heavens and the earth. It is my God who created the seas and all that's in them. It's my God that had brought up this storm, because my God is pursuing me." "What have you done?" they asked. And I said, "Well, I tried to run away. And if you want this storm to stop, then there's only one thing you can do, and you need to throw me into the sea." At first, they were reluctant to do so. They were afraid that if this was a God so powerful as to whip up the storm and come after me, that what would that God, our God, friends, what would our God do to them if they cast me overboard? But then the wind howled one last time, and they picked me up and threw me into the water. Years later, I ran into that boat's captain, and he was telling me that as soon as I went under the water, the storm stopped. The wind stopped blowing and the waves stopped crashing, and everyone on board the boat got down on their hands and knees and began to pray to my God, our God. He told me that as he knew many of those sailors, and he himself continued to that day to worship El Shaddai, God Almighty, because they had seen God's power and they had recognized how God had had mercy on them. When I heard that story, it made me think of the power in God's word. That even though I was trying to flee and get away and was trying to avoid God, God was still using me as a messenger to others. That not only were they saved from the storm, but they were saved for eternity. As I sank down deeper and deeper into the water, the darker it became. Dark and deep. It was like being enveloped in a blanket, a cocoon that it kept getting darker and darker and more encompassing until it completely surrounded me. In my native tongue, we have a word for this. It comes from the book of Genesis, of the deep, dark waters of the abyss. To whom? To whom? And this is where I came to rest. But remember, our God is a God of mercy. And our God makes all the creatures in the sea. And so God sent the big fish to scoop me up from the bottom of the ocean. For 3 days and nights, I stayed in the belly of the big fish, although I couldn't tell you which was which, the day or the night, because it was so dark in the belly of the fish. It was like no light present. It was like being deep down in the ground in a cavern or a cave deep below earth. It was like being in a tomb. For 3 days and three nights, I sat in the tomb. And it was there that I came to realize that God was relentlessly pursuing me. Because of God's deep love, not just for me, but for those people that I despised. That God loved them too so much that God would do anything for me to deliver the message of repentance to them. And so there in the belly of the whale, the belly of the big fish, I began to lament my actions. I asked for forgiveness from God for what I had done and my trying to run away. I asked God to allow me to fulfill my role, to answer the call that God was placing on me in that moment. Somewhere in there, around that third day, the big fish spit me out onto the beach. And that's where I rested. And when I awoke in the morning, the Word of God spoke to me a second time. Get up, Jonah, and go. Go to that great city, Nineveh. For their evil is more than I can stand, and I want you to preach to them. And so I got up, and I looked down that road, and took a deep breath, and went to Nineveh. Nineveh was indeed a great city. It took 3 days to walk across it. And as I hit the city gate, I began to call out in words that you today would understand. Something to the effect of, repent, change your hearts, change your lives. The kingdom of God is here. Repent, change your hearts, change your lives. The kingdom of God is here. Repent, change your hearts and change your lives. For the kingdom of God is here. Over and over and over as I walked through the city from one end to the other. Hour upon hour, change your hearts, change your lives. The kingdom of God is here. And the people heard God's word. I was just the messenger. Because, friends, there's power in God's word. And from the lowest of the low to the highest of the high, from the servants in the field hands to the king in the royal court, everyone repented. Everyone dressed themselves in sackcloth and put ashes over their heads and began to lament the way they had behaved and ask for God's forgiveness. They even dressed their animals up with sackcloth and put ashes on them. Every living creature in Nineveh over the course of those 3 days began to repent. They got down on their hands and their knees and asked God for forgiveness. And when I got to the end of the city, my 3 day journey across, preaching God's word to them, I left the city and went out on a hill in the desert to sit and watch to see what God was going to do. See, I knew that God was a God of mercy. I knew when God first called me to come to Nineveh that God would spare them if they only repented. And I knew the power of God's word that they would. I knew what God was going to do, or rather what God was not going to do. God was not going to destroy them. But there was that little spot in my heart that still hoped that God would. That hard place in my heart where even though I was doing what God wanted me to do, I still resented it. I was bitter with them and I was bitter with God, and I wanted those people to suffer. As I sat there on the hillside in the desert, the sun was scorching and the dry winds were blowing. And God raised up for me this big leafy shrub that just provided shade from the sun and a buffer from the wind. And I sat there in the shade of this shrub and watched and waited. The shrub sustained me that day and sheltered me. And as evening fell, and I reflected back on all that had transpired to that moment, I remember the words of the psalmist. Where can I go from your spirit? Oh, where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. And I lay down and slept. In the morning when I awoke, my big green shade-bearing leafy shrub had dried up and died. It was no more. It had wilted and it lay all around me. In the night, a worm had climbed into its root and had eaten the roots, had eaten the very foundation of the plant, so that they could receive no sustenance and no nourishment. When it finished with the root, it ate its way up the stalk of the big shrub. It ate the inside out of it, so that nothing was left but a hollowness. And with that, it dried up and died. It took me a long time to realize that even after I had done what God asked me to do, even after I had answered the call, that hardness in my heart was killing me, eating me from the inside. And that's no way to live. My new friends, there are many lessons in my story. And I hope today that you have found one that speaks to you. May the God of mercy grant you peace. Amen.
Thank you.
You lived amongst the least of these, the weary and the weak, and it would be a tragedy for me to turn away. All my needs you have supplied.
Give all
Hey, thank you, guys.
Alan, I don't know where you went, but you just missed Jonah, man.
I know. I heard. It was awesome. Friends, let us pray. El Shaddai, God Almighty, we thank you for the gift of the day, for the sun that rose this morning and ushers in new light into a world that wrestles with its darkness. We thank you, O God, for continuing to have mercy on us, for sending messengers into our midst to bring us words of encouragement and hope, calls to repentance. That even when there's hardness in our hearts, O God, you do not abandon us. You pursue us, always wanting the best for us and for others. This morning, O Holy God, as we gather, we are mindful of the tension that continues to exist in our nation. We pray that you will pour out your wisdom, your peace upon our people, who are also your people. No matter whether we disagree with them or not, whether we blame them or not, whether or not we loathe them in the recesses of our hearts, help us to accept responsibility for who we are and to accept the opportunities that you gift us. Help us to accept your love and to share that good news by our words and our actions. Lord, today as we gather, we are mindful of those who are sick in our midst and in need of healing of bodies and spirits, those who are battling cancer and cancer treatments, those who are recovering from injuries and surgeries, those who are fighting chronic illnesses that sometimes just zap the energy out of us. We pray, oh God, for healing, for recovery, for strength and restoration. We pray that spirits will be lifted and bodies healed. This we pray in your powerful name. Lord, we pray this day for those who are battling the loneliness, the fatigue of isolation, those who are struggling with not being able to interact with friends and loved ones, those who miss hugs and handshakes. We especially this day, O God, pray for our elders and our kids, especially our teens who are social beings. Lord, surround them with love and let them know that they are loved, and not just by you, but so many in their lives. Give them words of hope and encouragement, and bring about the healing of their hearts. Lord, we pray for those today who are grieving death. In our community and within our church family, we pray for Bob Adams and his family at the death this week of his brother Raymond. Bring them comfort. We pray for those who are staring in the face of death. Grant those who are dying your peace. Assure them of your waiting reception for them. Help them to let go of whatever that they might be clinging to here on this earth, that they can fully embrace the promise of resurrection. Help those, O Holy One, who love them so much, to be strong and courageous, but to also have expressions of their sadness and to be able to do that and to acknowledge it, that it hurts when loved ones die. Surround them with love, O God, that they might know your presence in this darkness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And hear us, O God, as we come together this day to pray for, to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, let's stand and sing our final song, our ascending song this morning, My Lighthouse.
In my wrestling and in my doubts,
friends. It's been good to be with you this morning, and I hope you have a great day today. Receive this blessing. Sisters and brothers, we are not dismissed, and we are not free to just get up. God loves us, Christ calls us, and the Holy Spirit sends us. So make welcome the stranger in your midst. Get up and go work, creating spaces of justice and mercy. Get up and go learn. Sharpen the talents God has given you. Get up and go play, rejoicing in the wonder of God's creation. Go in the power of the Spirit to love and serve the Lord. Go to help and heal in all you do, for God loves you, and Christ calls you, and the Holy Spirit this day is sending you. Thanks be to God. Amen.